Do you know, like I said, our topic this morning is forgiveness and reconciliation. Forgiveness is a gift you give yourself. Reconciliation is a gift you give to others. But do you know, as of today, I think they've called up the SASH, but they sat and sat for a long time, that the Malaysian jet, the jumbo jet, that disappeared and fell into the sea has not been found. Do you know that? Do you know how big a jet is? This is a jumbo jet, really big. When they were looking for it, they said that part they are not, that the part they are suspecting the thing fell in is 15,000 feet deep. Do you know how deep the length of 15,000 feet? To describe it, they were using the Statue of Liberty. They were saying, I don't know if they say 100 or more stacked on top of one another. That's how deep that place is. And the Bible says in Isaiah, and I believe in Amos, it said, the knowledge of God, the glory of the Lord, the glory of the knowledge of God shall cover the earth as water covered the sea. So there's a knowledge of God that is available to whosoever want to hear and listen. God is not hiding it. He has documented it in a book. But the problem is, are we reading the book? And if we are reading, are we reading it to understand it and be able to apply it? And just as the water is so deep, so is the knowledge of God. But the amazing thing is that you can be a Christian for 20 years, 30 years. I beg to tell you that you and I don't know the Bible. The Bible is so simple, yet it's so complex. There was a boy reading the Bible in a bus, in the subway. And when he got to that part, the Bible said, God parted the Red Sea. He said, oh my God. And there was a professor sitting next to him. He said, why did you say, oh my God? He said, I just read in this place. Whereby they said, God parted the Red Sea. He said, yeah, but scientists are proving that it's during the dry season, when the river, when the ocean is so shallow that you can actually walk through it. He said, really? He said, yeah. Then the boy read a little further that God drowned the horses in the sea. He said, woohoo! In the place of shadow, God will drown a horse? Professor, what do you have to say to that? Professor said, I don't know. I remember I read in one place. This girl was reading a book. I was reading the Bible. And it was a plane. And somebody looked at her like, do you believe that? He said, yeah. She said, oh, that's nonsense. How can you believe such an ancient text? So, and the girl asked, are you an expert? I said, yes, I'm an expert on books like this and other things. So, okay, let me ask you a question. How can a cow eat grass and produce white milk? How could that, can you explain that? I said, no. Then the girl now starts saying, the story was talking about is that how can an animal eat the same food and then they lead to the production of different substance? And the man said, I can't explain it. So if you don't know anything about explaining something that is so plain, how can you tell me things that are not plain? So be quiet. So what I discussed this morning is going to be based on this understanding. Please, if you never learn anything about the Bible, I want you to understand this very clearly. Some of us think the Bible is of two parts. Right? We have the Old Testament and the New Testament. That is technically not correct. The Bible is of three parts. If you don't get this, you will never get the Bible. Are you hearing me? If you don't understand this, you will never understand the Bible. For simplicity's sake, your Bible will say Old and New Testament. But for the sake of understanding and the wisdom of God, You got to follow what God says. We have the Old Testament called the Scripture. Are you listening? We have the Old Testament called the Scripture. The Old Testament was already concluded when Jesus, when they came to Jesus and asked him, there was a lady that was married. Her husband died. She married the next brother, he died. She went down the line, married seven brothers, they all died and she died. Whose wife will she be when they get to heaven? And Jesus said, you know not the Scripture. It was referring to the Old Testament. The Old Testament is from Genesis to Malachi. Are you following me? In the book of Timothy, Paul said, Timothy, from a very young age, have you been learning about the Scripture? The Scripture is from Genesis to Malachi. Then in your Bible, from Matthew chapter 1 to Revelation, they call it the New Testament. It's not. From Matthew 1 to the last chapter of John is actually the historical record of the life of Jesus. Are you following me? It is the historical record of the life of Jesus. We always say something here, that Jesus died to make you right. It is the duty of the church to make you right. When you come to this church, I need you to be ready to press the delete button. But unfortunately, most of you are not. Why? I begged God and I asked God, but since he hasn't answered, so I'm not worried about it. I've told God, I said, God, until you bless me and give me what I need. Because people respect what they can see. Because some of the things I'm teaching you, if TDJ come here and spend 5 minutes and say exactly what I'm saying, you will not have any argument with it. You will just be, ah, it's TDJ now. But no, that's just fair me. I know what I know. So if you are here, please, open up your mind. Your mind is like a parachute. It doesn't serve you unless it is open. Don't come to church with a critical spirit. Even when you go to the movie, you know the actor never dies. But if you enjoy the movie, sometimes you are crying when the actor dies. Because you are into it. I want you to get into this and listen. If you have any question, just ask me and I will show you. Because I know what I'm talking about. Jesus, according to Galatians chapter 4, he said in the fullness of time, Jesus came. He was born under the law to fulfill what? To fulfill the law. Are you following me? Jesus was born under the law. And he was born to fulfill the law. So the life of Jesus was not the New Testament principle it comes to teach. In Quran, he said, I come in the volume of the book to do thy will, O God. He came to do the will of God. That's why when I question him, he said, I did not come to break the law. I come to do what? Fulfill the law. So everything Jesus was teaching in his life was under the obligation of fulfilling the law. Are you following me? So, the New Testament starts from Acts chapter 1 to Revelation. How do I put that? Go to Matthew chapter 26, verse 28. And then we're going to read one or two verses from the book of Hebrews. Matthew 26, 28. What did it say? Matthew 26, 28 says what?
For this is my blood of the new covenant.
Whoa! This is what?
My blood of the new covenant.
This is my blood of the new covenant.
Yes, sir.
Just read it. Finish it.
Shed for many for the remission of sin.
Oh, whoa. Let's unpack that, please. Where was his blood shed? But, okay, the physical manifestation of the blood, you know, we've discussed that because in the past we are confused. He said the blood was not shed on the cross. For simplicity's sake, because we discussed with you that the blood was shed was actually shed on the mercy seat in heaven. That's when our sin was completely forgiven. But for the illustration of what Jesus is saying here, is that this, and I'm like, what do you mean this? He said, what I'm telling you right now is what we inaugurate the New Testament. When I shed my blood, it will pay for the forgiveness of your sin. Are you following me? Thank you. Let's see. I didn't have it on the line, but let's see. Let's go to Hebrew and see what the book of Hebrew. The book of Hebrew talked a lot about this. Before that there must be debt for the testament to be enforced, there must be the debt of the testator, something like that. Let's see if we can find it. I didn't underline it, so if I can't find it quickly, I will just go ahead, but I know what it says there. It was talking about the fact that for there to be a forgiveness of sin, there must be the death of the one who inaugurates the New Testament. So that Jesus has to die. And okay, let me just read this. Like I said, I didn't underline it or even write it out. So let me see if this is will give me what I'm looking for. It talks about this in Hebrews chapter 8. Let me read from verse 7. He said, for if that first covenant, he's talking of the Old Testament, had been faithful, had been faultless, then no place will be sought for a second. Because finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. When you start reading your Bible, the whole of Jeremiah and Isaiah talks about this. God was promising that there's going to be a new dawn. A new dawn where there's going to be a new covenant. And that covenant only came into place at the cross when Jesus died for the sin of the world. Because God found fault with the old covenant. Are you following me? Okay, let me just read a little because that's not even my message. But I want to see if I can find that place, and if not, I will just paraphrase it and we'll move on, because what the Lord wanted to talk to you about this morning is the gift of forgiveness and the blessing of reconciliation. So let me just read a little more. Verse 9, not according to the covenant that I made with their father in the day when I took them by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue my covenant and disregarded them, says the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. 10. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their mind and write them on their heart. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. None of them shall teach his neighbor and none of his brothers, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know him, from the least of them to the greatest of them. I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sin and their lawlessness I will remember no more. In that it says a new covenant. It made a force obsolete. Now what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish. So what we are saying right here is that the fact is that good. 9:7 says, he said, but Hebrews chapter 9 verse 7 says, but into the second part the high priest went along once a year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the people's sins. The Holy Spirit indicating this, that the way into the holiest of all was not made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. It was symbolic for the priest, for the present time in which both gift and sacrifice are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to the conscience, concerned only with food and drink, with various washing and let's see, please let me just find this. I think this is it right here. What did you say? Yeah, that's exactly what I said. Because I was like, I wasn't planning on going there, but I can see some of your faces. Pastor, no, the New Testament and the Old Testament, that's what the Bible says. So I'm just trying to, because, see, let me tell you the reason why I'm doing this. There is a, There is an historical fact in Athens. When Aristotle of Galileo was a professor at the University of Athens, he postulated that whenever you drop two objects from the sky from a high building, the heavier one will land first because the force of gravity will pull it down quicker than the lighter one. But then a young scientist came and said, no, the forces of gravity will pull them down at the same speed. And they said, who are you to be challenging the God of science? So to demonstrate to them, he took them to the Tower of Pisa in the University of Athens. And he held one big heavy object and another light one and dropped them at the same time, and everybody saw him land, proving his point. Disproving the other point, guess what they did? They still went back to the classroom and was teaching the old doctrine. That's what Christians do. You hear, but you are not persuaded. But the word of God should be persuasive enough. Because I'm telling you, if you don't get this basic principle of the Bible interpretation, you will struggle all your life. You say, but the Bible says, no, there are different dispensations. Why are you bringing goat and donkey to this church now? Why are you speaking blood on the altar? Because that dispensation was passed. For you to understand the dispensation of grace, you must see the transition. That there was something called the Old Testament, which was God running the show through prophets, seers, kings, and monarchs, and whoever he wants to use. And then, when the fullness of time came, according to what he prophesied in the book of Malachi, the Son of Righteousness, called Jehovah Shalom, showed up in the body of a baby called Christ. Then Galatians now tell us he was born under the law to fulfill the law. But all he did was he was operating under the full anointing of God as a man. That's why he cannot be in two places at the same time. That's why he hungered and he thirsted. Jesus came as a man, fully possessed by God, to show us what is possible. And then when he died, he opened a new way called the New Testament, called the Spirit of Grace. So I just show you in Matthew 26, verse 28, he said, this is the New Testament in my blood. You know what? On Wednesday here, I was trying to tell people, I said, you know what? Jesus didn't struggle with his disciples. Because until you have the gift of the Holy Spirit, you cannot understand what God is saying to you. Because the Bible says, to be carnally minded is death. Christianity does not make any sense to you unless God opens your eye. The Bible says, it says, the God of this world, Satan, has blinded their mind, lest they see the glory of the Lord. Jesus was talking to the disciples on three occasions. I'm going to the cross and die. They didn't believe him. They didn't. But the Pharisees who had him, he wasn't talking to the Pharisees directly, but they had him. They went to Potiphar. They said, that joker said he will rise after he has been killed. Let's guide. Let's put soldiers to protect the place where we bury him. The people fighting for him believed him. But his followers didn't believe. Why? It is impossible to digest the things of God unless the Spirit of God is given to you. So Jesus told them on the last night in John chapter 16, he said, I have so much to tell you, but you can't bear it. I'll bet you what I will say. The Spirit of truth, called the Holy Ghost, will come and teach you and bring it to your remembrance, all truth. Are you following me? So please, if you don't get this point very clearly, you will be confused. Because you keep saying, it's in red. Jesus said, Jesus said, Jesus said, but there is a transition in the Bible. And that's what we're going to talk about today when we talk about forgiveness. But let's establish this. So Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12 says, not with the blood of goats and car, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once for all, having ordained eternal redemption. How did he purchase eternal redemption? Through his blood. Verse 13. For in the blood of bulls and goats, and the lash and the ashes of heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctify for the purifying of the flesh. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offer himself without spot to God, cleanse our conscience from the dead work to serve the living God. Let's read verse 15 and then we'll move on. We'll just go on because I see what I'm looking for is just being explained now. And for this reason, he is the mediator through his blood of the new covenant. So even in God's dictionary, the new covenant started with the shedding of the blood. He said, for this reason, that's verse 15, Hebrews 9:15. For this reason, he is the mediator of the new covenant, by means of what? Death. For the redemption of the transgression under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. 16. For where there is a, this is, oh, thank you, Jesus. This is the verse I've been looking for and we'll be reading all the day. For where there is a testament, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. Are you following the Bible? For there to be a new testament, there must be the death of the testator. As long as you're alive, your will is ineffective. You might write a will, but you can change it a minute before you die. There's a living will, if you get sick, that can come into effect. But for a will to be of effect, the one who wrote the will must die. So here the Bible says, for the new covenant to be established, there must be the death of the testator. Are you with me so far? Okay. So what happened now is this. So we have Christ who came to show us the way as a man. Because the Bible said, Jesus was full of the Spirit of God, going about doing good and delivering all of them that were oppressed of the devil because God is with him. Alright. So remember what we want to talk about. So we've established that the New Testament starts from the day of Pentecost. The New Testament started from the day of Pentecost. Without the Spirit of the living God, without the Holy Spirit, you cannot be a Christian. He told Nicodemus, he said, you must be born again. That was how? And basically, it is the Spirit that will give you the regeneration. So the New Testament starts from the day of Pentecost, from Acts chapter 2, on down. Why? Now, Christ is the one speaking through the people. Yeah, there's a learning process. We're not going to discuss that today. But we want to talk about forgiveness. And when Christians talk about forgiveness, they actually abuse God. Because they will say, because Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, I think that's in Matthew, let's see, is that Matthew chapter 6? When they said, teach us to pray. It said, forgive us as we forgive our debtor. Because if we don't forgive our debtor, God will not forgive us. Is that I'm sure that's, yeah. It says, chapter 6, let's see where it says. Okay, verse 14, it says, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. 15, but if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. How many have heard that before? You know what? You need to understand the Bible. That's what I'm telling you. If everything I've said in the last 20 minutes, you dozed off and you didn't understand it, it doesn't matter what I said now, you will still go and do what you need to do. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling you, there's a transition in the Bible. And the transition starts in the New Testament called the book of Acts chapter 2. So simply because it's in red, doesn't mean it's operational today. You cannot use yesterday's anointing to defeat today's enemy. Daily must he load you down with his blessing. So, this is what Jesus said under the old covenant. There was not a Christian. Hear me. See, the problem with us is that we don't know what we have. You don't know what it means to be a Christian. Because some I'm like, you know, people should be so excited in this church based on the revelation that God is giving us here. Because if you understand, I was teaching on heaven a few weeks ago, and I showed you our destination. I showed you the plan of God for each and every Christian who believed Him. How many of you remember that? How the new heaven, how you can't just live to satisfy yourself and your family alone, that if you do that, you are missing the big thing. Because everything will end at the throne, where God will reward each and every one according to how we have lived our life. That there are two books. There is one called the Book of Life, in which everybody's name who is saved is in it. Then every one of us have our own personal book. The book where how written you've done for God is recorded. How? He said, when I was sick, you visited me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was homeless, you invited me to your house. And then he said, when I was in prison, you visited me. He said, when did we do that to you? He said, if you've done it to any, the least among my people, you have done it unto me. So your reward will be based on how you use your life. And that if we really understand Christianity, we live our life doing good. So that on that day, we can receive our own crown of reward. And then we describe what the new heaven looks like according to Revelation chapter 23. So, somebody asked me a question 2 Bible studies ago. He said, what's the difference between being a Christian and a non-Christian? I said, a Christian who really understands what Christianity is all about is somebody who is fearless about dying. You can't scare me with death. It's impossible. I'm already a dead man. Because the moment you gave your life to Christ, you're already dead. The life now you live it through the glory of the Son of God that lives in you. But when we are confused, we don't know the Bible. We start going back to the Old Testament. Like my daughter asked, and Spark will answer that question too. I said, well, I was going to deal with it in summer, but God said, don't worry about it. About baptism. Do you know what the Bible says? John the Baptist himself says, baptize you with water. But the one who is coming, what will he baptize you with?
Blood.
With the Holy Ghost. He said, me, I'm the least. All I can do now is to bury you in water. And that's why you can go down a living sinner, a dead sinner, and come back a risen sinner. Because water don't do nothing. But when the Spirit of God possesses you, there are things you cannot do. Because you know the resident master is always watching. So God said, no, just explain. Even John the Baptist himself said, this one I'm doing now is just for the time being. But when the real deal showed up, you will not need water. You will need the Spirit of God to baptize you. Most Christians don't know what they have. If you know what you have, you are ever ready. So while you are alive, you just live fearlessly, live passionately, live with vigor, so that God can flow through you. So when we don't understand the Bible, say, Pastor, is in red. It says, if you don't forgive, God will not forgive you. So Jesus become a big liar. Because on the cross, first of all, the book of Romans said, while we are yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. He's never waiting for you. Because if you control what heaven does, you are the master. When we don't understand the Bible, you know, whatever you bind in heaven is bound. Whatever you bound on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you bound, no. What the Bible is saying right is that God is saying, Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And based upon your confirmation and declaration that I'm the Son of God, I give you the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth is what has already been bound in heaven. Just the way that Peter was able to tap into the vein of God and see what heaven was declaring, that Jesus is not the man but the Son of God. It means when you pray and you're in the Spirit, God will show you what has been bound in heaven. And you will use that same connection to bind it on earth. Are you following me? You cannot bind anything on earth unless it has been bound in heaven. You are not the one in control. God is the one in control. So you cannot